This is the RPG Check. Welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. We're continuing the exploration of the Copper Lane district of Defiance Bay. This man here has just asked us if we can find his beloved, or the ghost of his beloved, in the catacombs. Her name's Rowena. We'll get to it at some point.
Sure.
Is this anyone important? Commoner. Commoner, okay. Now what is this? Looks like some kind of amphitheater or something set up over here. Check that out. Have you been to the Goose and Fox yet? Best inn in the city. Yes, we have. Crumbled loaves and shredded flyers float on the waters. Same there. Some of the plays they put on at the amphitheater are quite good. Well, I was right. That's what it is. What it is. Audience member. I heard there are less tame performances somewhere in Andra's Gift. That Orlin is so funny. Oh, Laughton, she calls to me, the pallid knight. And you have such poor luck with women as it is. I cannot die yet. My children! What of my children? But you have no children. Of course I do, you fool. A wealth of them. Great armfuls of golden... That is, golden-haired tots, all of whom I love dearly. What was he about to say? Ha! And so, yes? I'm just, like, basically walking on stage. Why, look, a weary traveler, drawn by your flute. Back into the stands with you. And though it may splinter my soul, I will... just warming up. I will not... You're citing his lines. Do you like theater? I can't answer you. I come here as often as I can. Lumdala? Lumdala. Go talk to Lumdala. Just look over here for a sec. Lumdala. Kadal. You go that way. We may or may not be able to talk to Lumdala. Let's see. The statuesque woman has a gaze that could cut stone. She turns her chiseled cheekbones to the sky and favors you with a look of acknowledgement. Her eyes shimmer under silvered eyeshadow and a razor-precise line of kohl. Before you can speak, she throws her hand up in dramatic fashion.
Well met, friend.
Autographs after the performance, please. Great art requires great concentration, and greatness is expected from the revel of the stars. What is the revel of the stars? We are the finest theater troupe in the city. We believe that the best art is immersive and true to life. She looks at the amphitheater with a rapturous expression. We stage our performances right here in Copper Lane for the edification of all. I suppose I can spare a moment for a fan. What do you do? That depends entirely on the demands of the role. She lays a slender hand on her chest. I am the pallid knight, the widow of the wood, and the warrior queen Maka. All at different times. To live a different life each day is a glorious thing indeed, my friend. Does the revel of the stars take in many new members? But of course, good drama is a balm to the soul, and we wish to offer a true theatrical experience to as many as possible. What kind of members do you take? We'll take in the new and old, the tall and small, the experienced and inexperienced, whoever is best suited to fulfill a role to the utmost. How long do you keep members? As long as they are able to satisfy the demands of their roles, She smooths a wayward strand of hair. True acting can be a grueling process, so some last longer than others. That's all I can ask. And who's this guy? Kadal. Sorry, I can't talk right now. Well, damn you. Damn you right to hell, sir. The benches are strewn with chicken bones, broken bottles, and greasy scraps of paper. I guess they held food. Well, we're done here. But I can't juggle. What? Don't you know how? Yes, but I haven't the balls for it. Groan. Oh, I get it. A little slow on the uptake, aren't you? Alright, that's good for that. I guess we're done here. That's all we have to do here. Well, there is to see. Okay, so I guess we'll make our way around. We've been here, and we headed this way, so we'll make our way clockwise. And see what else there is in this district before moving on to the next. Commoner, refugee, just to see our... Igwin's weapons are decent, but nothing compared to what we make at First Fire's Keep. Okay, so this is the way to First Fire's. That's the catacombs. There's the Hall of Revealed Mysteries. That's interesting. The world map. Marketplace is over there. Excuse me. Reasonable people. Seen that before. Ooh, Scrivener. What's up there, Scriveners? Someone's been reshelving improperly. When Fexa finds out... What the hell's that? Well, I guess we're checking out the Hall of Revealed Mysteries. Oh wait, let's look at these guys first. Here's a historian. Oh, another vibrant history. You see a small crowd gathering near the entrance to a temple. This man stands against the wall, the crowd forming a semicircle around him. He speaks with a calm, measured tone, his soothing voice carrying over the sounds of the surrounding city. He speaks of the world, history, the gods, and religion. He speaks of cooking, brewing, child-raising, and old wives' tales. There does not seem to be a subject he lacks at least a passing knowledge in. People ask him questions, and he answers them in turn, sometimes being detailed and in-depth, other times only giving a general answer. Regardless of what is said, all of his answers seem to hit to the heart of what was asked, each person satisfied with what they've learned. People come and go from the crowd, its size growing and shrinking, but never completely dissipating. Hours pass, and he never seems to tire, sharing his knowledge with anyone who would benefit from it. As the light of day wanes, the group finally growing small enough that he draws everything to a close. As he gathers his belongings and prepares to leave, a man approaches him, asking why he does this. He asks for no money, no food. What benefit is gained from his actions? He looks at the man, gathering his thoughts, then simply tells him, "Knowledge brings wisdom. That is my faith." And Oleg Shimonovsky? You see a dark room, its contents in display. The blinds are pulled against the light, and the sounds of shouting and running can be heard outside. This man moves through a house, throwing items into a bag. He wraps up some food, collects some clothes, and searches through a chest for various odds and ends that resemble magical components. He stops at a bookshelf and quickly scans the spines, running his fingers along them to help keep his place. He sighs, sliding his finger across the spines again, mumbling to himself. Finally, he chooses a couple of titles and takes them from the shelf, adding them to the assortment of items he has already gathered. A small group of squirrels and birds watch him as he passes through the rooms, moving almost as a single entity. They are trying to stay near him, but they also seem to know to stay out of his way. He is obviously in a hurry, but he maintains a deliberate demeanor about everything he does. The outer door bursts open with an explosive sound, causing the animals to scatter, terrified. The man turns, bringing a hand up, holding a book in his other, whispering something that barely can be heard. Ice crystals begin to form at the tips of his fingers, crackling against the heat of the room. He sees the man standing in the doorway and immediately drops his hands, the ice vanishing as quickly as it appeared. The man in the doorway gestures, telling him to hurry, and points toward the horizon somewhere outside. The man in the house dismisses him with a wave, saying he's almost done here and will be coming soon. He scans the dwelling one more time, searching for something he might have missed. Satisfied, he leaves, not even bothering to close the door. Outside he can see people, all prepared as he is, traveling away from town, away from the rising plumes of smoke on the horizon. Huh. Is it his own house? Here I thought he might have been stealing from someone's house. I'm not even sure, actually, still. Scrivener again? Grimda is especially cranky today, and that's saying something. Someone actually stole something from the hall? How'd they manage to do that? We'll just stay in the middle of you guys. Whale only knows. Grimda's looking for someone to blame, though, so stay clear of her for a few days. The library has an entire section devoted to ancient Glamfellen geometry. Someone's been reshelving improperly. Yeah, I've seen that. How disappointing, we can't walk on the grass or anything like that. Colorblind mode. I do know a few people who would be, you know, really
I'd
appreciate
wager
that.
There are more than a few banned books in here.
So here we are in the Hall of Revealed Mysteries. Well, there's this Fexa himself that you've been talking about. Johnny Hawka, Scrivener, Priest of Whale. Welcome to the Hall of Revealed Mysteries. The books on these shelves cover the history and mythology of Old Valia. Johnny Hawka. Oh, another history. You see nothing at first, inky darkness filling your vision, the dust of eons flooding your nose. You hear a strike, and a torch gutters into flame, revealing a man without a face and a library of books flickering in the dull orange glow. He moves to the closest shelf, sliding the torch into a socket, and gingerly pulls a black-bound book into his trembling hands. He flicks through it lovingly, caressing each page before turning to the next, and the next. Finally he finishes, placing the book in a satchel to his side, and takes down the torch. He spends hours wandering, reading, collecting, until his satchel is as thick as he himself and half as heavy, and begins to make his way back to the entrance. With a barely audible sigh, he draws two decaying doors closed, and the torch is extinguished. I almost read that perfectly. Almost. I gotta run around all here to talk to this person. The library has an entire section devoted to ancient Glamfellen geometry. The symbols on these pages writhe and shift. They're dizzying to look at. Records of books borrowed and returned fill the cubby holes. Priest of Whale. It takes a smooth tongue to solve problems, doesn't it? May the 100 visions be revealed to you. Let's talk to this guy. Fexa.
How do you do?
Or a woman, sorry. The woman barely glances up from the tomes on the table as you approach. You're welcome to browse the stacks, but mind that you keep your voice down. This is still a temple, after all, and Grimta doesn't tolerate disorder. This is a temple? It looks more like a library. Her eyes grow wide and round. That's because it is. Whale is the god of mysteries and answers, encryption and decryption, concealment and revelation. She raises her hands to the row of shelves. Its guidance comes from the understanding of the unknown and the protection of hidden knowledge. The Hall of Revealed Mysteries was built to celebrate that. Kanna says, to think there's such a place in the Deerwood. Incredible. I'd love a glimpse of the archives. How many secrets must sit upon these shelves? Fascinating, Captain. Isn't it? Temples dedicated to Whale tend to hold a vast stores of knowledge. We use that knowledge to unravel and preserve the mysteries of the world. Anything else? Who's Grimda? Fexa speaks reverently. Why, she's the High Archivist. She's one of the most accomplished scholars alive today. Nothing goes on here without her knowing about it. Almost nothing, anyway. She scratches behind her ear. You should probably tread lightly around her today. Tell me about yourself. She throws her broad shoulders back. I am a scrivener and a devotee of Whale. It is my duty to look after our records and resources. Her chest swells with pride. Well, farewell. Alright, so there's stuff we can look at. There's books and shelves we can peek at here. Can we take anything? Will they attack us? The Aedyr Empire Part 2 and the Midwife's Memoirs.
I'm on the trail.
Can we take this stuff? Will they attack? Hold on a sec. I don't know if we have this book. If we do, I'm gonna leave it. What is it? The Aedyr Empire Part 2. Do I have any Aedyr Empires, Deerwood? Thought I did, but I might have been getting it confused with the Deerwood books. Grab it. The Midwife's Memoirs. My mother lived every note of life's song. Bringing me into this world was her last verse. For this my father scorned me and abandoned me, and for this very same fact my town's midwife and adherent of Hylia raised me as her own. When I came of age, I learned that Hylia visits us on the screams of women in childbirth, and when a woman dies giving life to her child, her soul is carried away and reborn as an avian attendant of Hylia's court. Through the miracle of the Queen of Birds, my mother has been with me, watching over me my whole life. I wear the fetish charms of the Cloud Singer, the bird I dreamt my mother became. My feathery trinkets look gaudy and unbecoming, but it is a signal fire to women in need that I am a trained midwife, blessed by Hylia in living every note of life's song. The Queen of Birds wills us to shepherd new life into the world, and not, as the other gods so often desire, to end it. A follower of Magrin once mocked my faith, saying I worshipped paintbrushes and birds, piddling things beneath the gods. I do not resent the other gods and the brutal necessities that they must oversee, but it is not language, love, the arts, and creativity that which separates us from simple beasts. Hylia allows us to rise above our savage, feral selves. I am often amused that, upon seeing our holy aviaries, visitors frequently ask, "This is nice, but where is the real temple of Hylia?" Perhaps they think hallowed ground requires oppressive stoneworks and ceilings that hide the sky. They do not realize the Bird Queen stands not on ceremony. She makes herself manifest in the music of birds and in beauty of the ubiquitous open sky. Hylia prefers the worship of two children singing over 1,000 petitioners silently praying for victory. The Sky Mother asks so little of us, and yet so much. We are charged to live every note of life's song. It surprises me how many fail to embrace this divine calling. Book of the Hunt, The Aedyr Empire, Part 1. When my students ask to be taught the way of Galloway, I tell them they have already failed. Does one ask a deer to present itself as dinner? Of course not. One must outwit, outmaneuver, and overpower the deer if one dreams of venison. So it is with the seeker god. To ask a question is weakness and idle indecision. To seek answers is to understand, and to become one with Galloway. Survival begins with strength from within. But I only strike my students when they ask a second stupid question, for all of us begin young and weak. It is a point fact, and not one of shame. An essential tenet to Galloway's teachings. Shouldn't it be tenet? T-E-N-E-T? Perseverance and cleverness apprised by Galloway above brute force, a fact my young pups often forget. It is right and proper that the strong lead the weak, and is equally proper that the balance... It is equally proper that the strong be continually tested until the balance changes. Galloway celebrates the strength of the victor and the prowess of the well-fed predator, but above all, the clever hound celebrates the transformative nature of strength. Galloway's greatest desire for us is that prey becomes predator. Yuling babes grow into strong hunters, and the lost find their own enlightenment. The philosophy is best exemplified by the rites of Anamfatha of Ir Glanfath. When one of the Glanfathan spiritual leaders is old and nearing death, it is customary to enter the woods and confront Galloway's herald. If the seeker god finds that Anamfath's life, deeds, and soul worthy, the reward is a quick death, and his soul joins Galloway's pack. If deemed unworthy, the Anamfath is killed, his soul forced to find its own way to the next life, and his memory erased from the records of the tribe. Survival begins with strength from within, and weak leaders endanger the whole pack. This is Galloway at his purest. Even at the end of life, one must struggle for worthiness, for greatness, just as one must struggle every day to feed his pack. The seeker god is easy to understand if one actively engages in the quest for knowledge, but his secrets are self-occluding to those who merely ask, desiring knowledge without the requisite hunt. My own flesh and blood once asked me, "Will learning to hunt please Galloway?" I told him yes, but added, "Galloway would prefer that you hunt to learn." Interesting. Hope you guys don't mind too much. I'm going to read these books and put them away. I don't have... I guess it was the deerwood I had. I mean, they're blue books, and there's not... I don't have too many blue books. Just don't want to read something I already read, but I guess I haven't read them. The Aedyr Empire, Part 1, Origin. In approximately 2200 AI, a group of tribes called the People of the Deer unified into a new civilization called the Aedyr Kingdom. The tribes, small and widespread over the land, knew it would be better for their continued existence to unify. The leaders of each tribe became advisors to the king, chosen by the group. Each advisor would still be lord over his people, but each lord would answer to the Faerconing, first king. The decision turned out to be exactly what was needed, and the Aedyrian kingdom thrived, spreading out over the land, establishing strong trade routes, and becoming... And became known to be fair, but shrewd, businessmen. While the country thrived, and internally there was little strife, there were still the occasional skirmishes where the neighboring with the Avering... Sorry, guys. I'm reading a lot here. Occasional skirmishes with the neighboring elven kingdom of Kolkin. Do they worship the great Macaulay? Not long after the kingdom was formed, the Aedyrian people began studying animancy. Still largely unknown at that time, it was an exciting, terrifying new realm that Aedyrian scholars saw great potential in. This potential came to bear fruit in 2260 AI when a group of animancers, working together, transferred the soul of a recently departed man into another body, creating the first of what would later come to be known as the Undead. The reaction to this discovery was swift and decisive. Both the King of Aedyr and the Church of Vortica condemned this event, and the study or practice of animancy was outlawed. It would never again be practiced openly on Aedyrian soil. Conflicts with Kolkin continued, escalating into a minor war in 2398 AI. Afterward, a treaty was signed and the Kingdom of Aedyr merged with Kolkin to form the Aedyr Empire. With the political and military strife now settled, the Aedyr Empire would become an economic powerhouse. Able to provide resources that were hard to find in other parts of the world, their trade routes became some of the most lucrative in the world. Okay, so that's one. And then part two, expanding borders. In 2602 AI, Aedyrian explorers returned from over the ocean, telling tales of the ruins and treasures there, and of expansive fields that were perfect for growing vorlas. The explorers warned the Faerkoning that the locals were not friendly to others, but the Faerkoning, seeing this as an opportunity to extend his empire and secure trade on another continent, sent more explorers. Over the next 20 years, the area that would become the Deerwood was investigated, mapped, and colonized. In 2363, the first permanent Aedyrian colonial settlements were established. Vorlas fields were set up north of the forests in the Deerwood, but between the conflicts with the Glamfellens and the War of the Broken Stone, it floundered. It wasn't until 2643 that the opportunity presented itself again. Some Eothasian pilgrims, wanting to escape persecution, established colonies and vorlas farming operations in the territory of Red Saras. I guess vorlas is some kind of crop. With Granvalia on the verge of collapse, the Faerkoning wanted to ensure his hold on the purple dye trade would be established. He encouraged the settlement and even paid to have the pilgrims set up in the New World. Drink. Because the Faerkoning was still trying to secure his name in the purple dye trade, he was unable to properly respond to Admeth Hadrat when he issued his ultimatum. To avoid a rebellion and leave himself time to oversee the Vorlas farms in Red Saras, the Faerkoning relented and made Admeth a Gref Palatine. In return for this concession, Admeth spent time and resources on the Deerwood's trade and shipping routes, benefiting the Faerkoning with increased income. For 7 years, the Deerwood provided Aedyr with steady income, leaving the Faerkoning time to ensure his trade system in Red Saras was strong. With the Faerkoning's attention elsewhere, Admeth instituted the 10 Years Treaties, ending slavery in the Deerwood and permanently removing one of the revenue sources provided by the Deerwooden explorers, the artifacts from the ruins scattered throughout the Deerwood. At this point, the Faerkoning's word meant almost nothing to the citizens of the Deerwood. Admeth Hadrat had replaced him as their true leader. In order to undermine Admeth's standing, the Faerkoning found allies willing to explore the ruins, against the treaty conditions, and plunder them. Soon, Aedyr again had a supply of artifacts to sell. When his agents were eventually caught, the Faerkoning distanced himself from the operation, certain there was no way to link him to the proceedings. But the Gref, using means provided him by his Glamfellen allies, discovered the evidence needed to prove the Faerkoning was behind the plunderers. The conflict that arose from this revelation led to Admeth declaring independence for the Deerwood in 2668 AI. After a bloody 4-year-long war that resulted in the death of Admeth, the Faerkoning relented. Trying to keep control of the Deerwood had become too costly. He signed treaties with the new Duke of the Deerwood and returned his attentions to Red Saras, redoubling efforts on the Vorlas trade, which is still running today. Donye. I just want to see what's in here. I think I have the Arakian or Orochian calendar or whatever it's called. Grimda's been furious ever since that scroll went missing.
My eyes are peeled.
Hmm?
I don't know if we're allowed to just take these books. Probably not.
My eyes are peeled.
Right in front of this guy. That's not gonna work. Grimda is especially cranky today, and that's saying something. The Travels of Errol of Levi, 2668 to 268. If you think these books are impressive, you should see what Grimda keeps in the back. I've got an echo in here. I love the smell of old books.
Laying low.
See if I can get into that cupboard, or shelf, rather. Who can see me? Why am I still... No entry into the archives without Grimda's permission. How'd you see me, man? Oh, there's Grimda herself. Handle the books gently, please. I can't get to these books. Which might be a good thing.
Nice and quiet.
Ten Years of Dawn, I think we have that. And Aedyr Customs, let me see. Yep, we have it. I'll read about Aedyr Customs. There's the Arakian calendar. New. We'll just take that one. Aedyr is a country rich with custom, and they are known for their strict adherence to them. Their customs run the gamut from grand celebrations, like the Feast of Feasts, to mundane superstitions, such as ways to avoid svef addiction. This volume will focus primarily on bigger celebrations, as no one knows how to throw an extravagant party quite like an Aedyrian. The Feast of Feasts. The biggest and most important of all Aedyrian customs is the Feast of Feasts. This week-long celebration happens the first week of Fanestu, deep summer, and is dedicated to honoring the life of the first Faerconing. Each day of the week is devoted to some aspect of the Faerconing's life, and there are very specific dishes to be served at each meal. The Feast of Feasts originally began as a festival celebrating the birth of the Faerconing's first son, and soon became a yearly occurrence during the week of his birthday. Currently, Aedyrians simply use it as an excuse for a party and pull out all the stops in an effort to outdo the previous year. And lest you wonder, as I did, which Faerconing is honored during the Feast of Feasts, it is always the current Faerconing, for each Faerconing is the first and only Faerconing. Yeah, makes sense. Not really. Sweet treat. A special custom that arose at some point during the Feast of Feasts, Sweet Treat started as a way to keep children occupied so the parents could dine in peace. While it is still used for that today, significance has been added to it. Each treat is placed in a container, usually small metal boxes, and hidden somewhere on the property. After everything has been hidden, the children are sent out to find the treasures. Sounds familiar. It is said now that the hidden treats represent Glamfellen artifacts and the children are the explorers, bringing the riches back to their new and rightful owners. Carnival of the Mask. When the original colonists for Aedyr traveled to the new land to found the Deerwood in the name of the Aedyrian Faerconing, they encountered the Glamfellen people. The Carnival of the Mask celebrates this meeting. Originally, it was merely a formal reenactment, as a play, of the tensions between the Glamfellens and Aedyrian settlers. But it has since evolved into much more than that. Participants choose sides and come dressed in elaborate outfits, depicting which group they have decided to align themselves with, Aedyrians or Glamfellens. Everyone attends a masquerade ball, and this party replaces any semblance of the play that was presented. Winter's End was never anything more than an excuse for a celebration, and it hasn't changed in all the years it has existed in Aedyr. It takes place during winter dusk and lasts all 3 days. People use the time to reflect on the year, celebrate their lives, and remember the dead, especially those who have passed in the recent year. Done. Alright, so what's our names over here? We have to explore these areas. I don't believe we've been in them. And we'll go talk to her next episode. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.